Don't stop to speak or look around. Your gloves and fan are on the ground. We're getting out of town. We're going on the run. And you're the one I want to come.
There is a word for it, and it's called charisma.
He was a piece of work from the moment that he stepped into our lives.
When Steve ran, somehow all this became magic. I mean, really, it was like magic.
And it seemed like whenever he came out onto the track, the sun came out.
Steve was the best athletic competitor I've ever seen anywhere at any time.
Even though you didn't want to be, you were intimidated by his aura.
He knew that there was more to himself and his destiny than just a normal existence.
He had just begun to reach maturity when this show was over.
He just had that, whatever that is, I don't know. Actors have it, singers have it, some people have it, some people don't. Most people don't. He had a lot of it.
He was the benchmark that we all tried to, you know, measure ourselves against.
He was so ferociously competitive in his sport. He understood that he was getting close to the limits in ways that few people do.
He was the kind of guy that when it came down to compete, he was spitting fire.
Of all the great athletes that have worn our products on the field of battle, we made a statue of only one of them, and that was Steve Prefontaine.
He was the best distance runner in the world the year he lost his life. He'd run against all the good runners. Nobody could touch him. And that was a great loss to track and field when we lost Pre.
The time to hesitate is through. No time to wallow in the mire. Try now, we can only lose. And our love become a funeral pyre. Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire. Try to set the night on.
After failing to qualify for the state meet as a sophomore, Prefontaine vowed never to lose another high school race, and he never would. He went undefeated in his final 2 years, setting an American high school record in the 2-mile run as a senior. His prowess earned him an invitation as a schoolboy to compete in the AAU National Championships. During the next 2 years, Pre went undefeated against collegiate competition outdoors, set American records in the 5 and 3,000 meters, and won 2 NCAA cross-country titles. Pre embraced running and life with a controlled aggression. He feared no runner, every distance a new challenge to be conquered. Barriers, once thought impregnable, crumbled before him.
Stories that were coming about back to us in the South about Prefontaine was that he was like a hero for whatever race he was in.
Talk about Muhammad Ali's float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. I mean, that was Pre. He went out and did it.
You know, I didn't know what to make of him exactly. You didn't see guys that young in that kind of competition be that bold.
He was a force. And he was very aware of that, call it power, charisma.
I couldn't understand why one of the best-looking girls on campus would come up and ask him for a date 2 weeks down the road, and he said, well, I don't know, I have to check my schedule. As a freshman in college, if you can imagine that.
We were like salt and pepper. You know, I was the bland person. I was introverted. I was married at the time. I was not a party goer. And Steve was the pepper. He was the spice. He was outgoing, extroverted, single, putting the moves on everybody. And we were just like Mutt and Jeff.
It was this style and panache that endeared him to the fans of Eugene. These were Free's people. Victories were a foregone conclusion. Haywood Field was more than just home field advantage. It became the house that Free built. George Young would present the biggest obstacle to Prefontaine at the Olympic trials, but Free had home track advantage. The hometown fans were whipped into a frenzy for Free's 5,000 meter showdown with Young. In classic Prefontaine style, he forged to the front early and never relented.
The roar of the crowd got to the point where, at one time, I remember standing in the middle of the field and yelling at Free as loud as I could and not being able to hear my own voice.
Free's people were hungry for victory, and he fed them what they wanted, an American record, and bold predictions that the best was yet to come.
How do you feel? You're number one now.
Well, all I can say is I hope I can stay fit. And if I can run like this in Munich, I think I'm going to be pretty hard to stop.
After basking in the victory, Free headed to Europe, where he set another American record. The Games of the 20th Olympiad, Munich, Germany. These were supposed to be the happy games, but the serenity was shattered and the Olympic Games were changed forever by Arab terrorists.
There are men with guns beginning to train those guns on the rooms where the two heads were sticking out a moment ago of the Arab guerrilla lookouts. This is happening now, if you can possibly believe that, at the Games of the 20th Olympiad.
The Olympic Games came to a stunning halt. With each passing hour, the tension built as the world watched in horror. The worst of all possible scenarios played itself out.
It now said that there were 11 hostages. Two were killed in their rooms yesterday morning. Nine were killed at the airport tonight. They're all gone.
Despite divided opinion, IOC President Avery Brundage decided the games must continue. Every athlete had to search their soul for the courage to compete, including Steve Prefontaine.
I think the initial reaction amongst all of us, we were all rooming together in the same room. We could look out from our balcony and see the room where all the Israelis had been housed. We could see the masked gunmen outside the rooms on their balconies. We all would stand there and look over on that day, and we thought early on that, you know, nothing's worth this. Nothing's worth human life. And everybody began to realize that the worst thing you could do would be to give in to the terrorist demands, which were really to disrupt the Olympics.
The games commenced after a one-day hiatus and pre-qualified for the 5,000-meter final against a formidable field. Finland's Lasse Virran, already the gold medalist at 10,000 meters, was the pre-race favorite.
Steve Prefontaine will be the Olympic 5,000-meter champion. I think he will break the world's record at 5,000 meters, but I think he will have to do it in Montreal. Because today, Steve Prefontaine, 21 years old, is running up against the very big boys. I think that Stewart's prediction of the last mile in 4 minutes is not unrealistic. That is what Steve Prefontaine will have to run if he's going to win this event today.
Prefontaine told me the other night, or about a week ago, standing in the lobby of the Sheraton München Hotel, he said, what I'm going to try to do is work it out so it'll be a pure guts race at the end, and if it is, I'm the only one who can win. And Steve Prefontaine is going to take the lead.
1 mile to go.
4 laps to go, that's it.
Free has got to run that 4 minute mile now. He's got to.
Here's Virran going for the lead. It seems impossible that Prefontaine can outkick Virran.
Or Gamudi.
Vatanen is no place. Vatanen will not be a factor with his fabled kick.
Gamudi
is going for his second gold medal of the games. Mohamed Gamudi is right with him. And so is Steve Prefontaine. The kid is showing all the guts in the world. He's hanging in there with the kickers. Prefontaine going for the lead with Gamudi. Virran is still there. Here comes Prefontaine. What this is coming to you live from the Munich Stadium. Nobody in the world knows how it's going to turn out until they head down this stretch, coming to the last turn.
Free is running a great race. What guts.
Here comes Behrend, going for his second gold medal. And I think he's going to win it, but Cavuti could have a kick. I don't think so. Behrend's going to win the gold. And here comes the Briton trying to pass Prefontaine for the bronze. It's going to be close. And it was Ian Stewart beating out Steve Prefontaine for the bronze medal as Prefontaine nearly collapsed in the last 5 meters.
Prefontaine finished his final year at Oregon undefeated, undaunted, and unemployed. The stark reality was that it was nearly impossible to train at a world-class level and earn a living.
It was like the grapes of wrath of track with his trailer. It really was very funny. I was very surprised when I you know, came to Eugene and it's like, this is where you live? And then confiding in me that he was on food stamps, it was like, God, you're kidding. This is one of the world's best athletes. And it was quite a contradiction.
When you'd go to a European track meet and say an obscure Italian hurdler would come up and say, hey, let's go get our money and go partying. We'd go, what money? And we'd find out that our federation was getting our appearance money and athletes from other countries were getting theirs.
Pre-galvanized his energy to try and loosen the AAU shackles. I love my country, but does it love me enough to let me go to Europe and get the experience I need to be the best distance runner in the world?
Pre was an angry voice for athletes' rights. He was always in trouble with AAU officials.
He really grabbed that situation by the balls, literally, and confronted the AAU, this old grand marshal school of a bunch of old stuffies, and brought up some real uncomfortable situations.
They tried to tell him which races to run, and if they weren't the races against the very finest competition, if they wanted to run dual meets against Poland, and he wanted to run against New Zealanders or Finns, and very few as they got better and better who could give him a good race, then we had a conflict.
Much like baseball's Curt Flood, who challenged the validity of management to limit a player's right to free agency, Steve Prefontaine began to openly question the AAU's right to govern American track and field athletes.
But I'm not really trying to get under anybody's skin. I'm just trying to bring the problems to a head and an understanding to make the people of this country realize what's happening in amateur athletics. And what's happening is that amateurs do not have the same benefits as, let's say, the Europeans. And I'd just like to bring this to the acknowledgement of the public.
Steve forced me to be a rebel. We were outside of the governing body. We were supposed to run in an AAU meet in Germany and Italy, Russia, and they started out in Africa. And we bypassed the African meets. And I can remember feeling so proud when I'd walk into the team meeting when we gathered together in Germany with Steve. And here Steve and I are walking in, you know, in open defiance of the AAU. They're saying, you better get down here or else.
It's a fundamental conflict in the history of American sport that had to be resolved in favor of the athletes. And it was fought and won in the 2 years after Pre died in 1978. The Amateur Athletic Act was passed, which guaranteed athletes' rights to compete when and where they chose.
A lot of sacrifices to be an amateur sport in this country, considering it's so professionally oriented.
During the struggle against the AAU, Prefontaine rejoined forces with Bill Bowerman. Innovator as well as coach, Bowerman developed new track surfaces and used his cobbler skills to build running shoes. Along with Phil Knight, another former Oregon runner, they formed a shoe company, mass-producing models designed for Pre.
For me, at least, he set a tone for this whole company.
You're talking 1973. Nike as a company was only a year old. And Steve joined us at that time as an employee, and we were all the early pioneers. But Steve was really the catalyst. I mean, he was the reason that we were in business. And there couldn't have been a more perfect athlete than Steve for Nike, because he had a certain level of rebel in him, no question about it. He wasn't a rebel without a cause, he was a rebel with a cause.
Made to wave the flag, ooh, they're red, white, and blue.
runner first and foremost. Free continued to burn up the track, setting five American records in 1974.
Speak or look around, your gloves and fan are on the ground. We're getting out of town, we're going on the run, and you're the one I want to come. See the sun, nothing left to do but run, 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 let's run, let's run. House upon the hill, moon is lying still, shadows of the trees, witnessing the wild breeze, come on baby, run with me, let's run. Run with me.
someone has that ability and tendency to want to run from the front until everybody else simply gives up, I think that's a talent that you don't discourage.
There is no holding back in his personality. There is no holding back in his train of thought. It was 100% at all times at everything he did.
The athletes have enough hassles without being told what to do, when and where, and throwing in new rules now and then to better themselves instead of the athletes.
Fontaine, he said, what I'm going to try to do is work it out so it'll be a pure guts race at the end. And if it is, I'm the only one who can win. He is a superbly confident young man. Some people have said cocky at times. And Steve Prefontaine is going to take the lead.
In the Olympics, I think you just go, and you go as hard as you can for as long as you can, because...
Steve Prefontaine, America's leading long-distance runner, was killed last night in a car accident in Eugene, Oregon. Around midnight, according to police, he was driving alone in a sports convertible. The car jumped the curb, hit an embankment, and flipped over, pinning Prefontaine underneath. He was 24.
Every single time you're up there, there's stuff, a token of their appreciation of him.
Steve influenced me greatly, and he certainly influenced a lot of people, otherwise the story wouldn't be told. He had charisma, he had energy, he had that glow. His running is what pushed him through new barriers. But as a person, I think we look at that kind of a personality and we all want some of that, that ability to...
There's a lot of factors that make me run. Probably the biggest one is that I enjoy it, or I have acquired an enjoyment for it after so many years of running. It's part of my life now. Another reason would have to be the Olympic Games and trying for a gold medal. And the third thing would have to be competition. I love to compete against people.
He put more into his life in the 24 years that he was on this earth than many people do in a lifetime.
It's better to burn out than to fade away.
I said, Pre, of all your American records, the one I like the best is the fact that you came to Oregon and spent 4 years with never missing a workout, 4 years without ever missing a race. He says, Coach, I gotta tell you, there was a few Saturday mornings when I really didn't feel like running.
Out in the blue,
Pre was a warrior, and if you didn't play by warrior rules, he didn't have much, much good to think of you.
And once you're gone, you can't ever come back. When you're out of the blue and into the black.
Prefontaine was this magnificent, magnificent, compelling presence of physical possibilities.
The king is gone, but he's not forgotten. This is the story of Johnny Rodden. It's better to burn out than it is to rust. The king is gone, but he's not forgotten.
Unfortunately, a lot of things died with Steve Prefontaine. I think the sport in the United States would be substantially different if he were still alive.
The moral of Steve Prefontaine is essentially fighting the good fight and fighting it very well and better every day.
The way he interacted with people was so much a result of his intensity and his focus on his running. That's entirely understandable.
When I remember when that passed, you couldn't help but think that his voice, coupled with the force, the shock of his death, had certainly hastened that day.
lot of my motivation to continue fighting the Federation in my own way and trying to work towards change was generated by the fact that I wanted to carry on what was really very, very important to Steve.
Whittier once wrote, "For of all sad words of tongue and pen, the saddest of these, it might have been." And that immortal line could certainly be applied to Steve Prefontaine.